Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Bilbury Chronicles by Vernon Coleman. Narrated by Rory Barnett. Chapter 1. There can be few more beautiful railway journeys than the one between Exeter and Barnstable. The train moves slowly and stops at a dozen small hamlets on the way, but the view from the window is overpoweringly rural. Oak and silver birch, hazelnut and walnut trees provide shade and shelter for foxes, badgers and deer. Thick, untrimmed hedgerows border lush, dark green meadows. Thatched roof cottages sit alongside streams and bridle paths. Herons haunt the shallows of the River Tor. Dippers and kingfishers decorate the banks, rocks and overhanging branches. And buzzards soar high overhead, unflapping and unflappable. It was 1971, and an early autumn afternoon when I first travelled on that train. And as it chugged slowly and peacefully along the river valley, through Lapford, past Eggersford and into and out of King's Nympton, the glorious majesty of the scenery was the last thing on my mind. You need to feel calm and relaxed to get the best out of this sort of journey, and I was feeling neither calm nor relaxed. I had no time for rich red soils, plump hilltops crowned with copses or slowly swirling pools of meandering river water. I was on my way to my first job, and to say that I felt nervous would be an understatement of grand proportions. I had finally completed my training as a doctor just 5 days earlier. My registration certificate, collected by hand from the General Medical Council, lay unfolded and hardly dry in a large, sturdy brown envelope at the bottom of my brand new black leather doctor's bag, a badge of office which had given me confidence and pride when I'd bought it, but which now seemed, by its very shiny newness, to advertise my inexperience and professional innocence. I'd got the job as Dr. Brownlow's assistant after a telephone interview that had lasted somewhere between a minute and a minute and a half. My conversation with his receptionist, who had told me which trains to catch, had lasted only slightly longer. Then, surrounded by the hospital wards and university laboratories where I'd trained, I'd been full of self-assurance. Now, swaying gently from side to side on a train which was steadily lurching its way towards the unknown, I felt almost overcome by great cold draughts of incompetence and ignorance. As the train took me nearer and nearer to my new job, I gradually realised that practising medicine as a senior student in a ward staffed by experienced doctors and briskly efficient, starch-fronted nurses was something entirely different to practising medicine out here in the wilderness. The real world was, I began to suspect, something that I might not be quite ready for. In hospital, my patients had mostly lain neatly in rows, dressed in their pyjamas and labelled with diagnoses and recorded symptoms. Advice and help was never more than a few moments away. Out here, in the real world, my patients were chopping wood, poaching trout, catering for holidaymakers, driving trains and herding cattle. I looked around the unfamiliar faces sharing my carriage. Were any of these, I wondered, potential patients of mine? Did they have any idea how much I wanted them to stay well and healthy? A large red-faced man, wearing a brownish tweed jacket, old-fashioned gaiters, and a pair of heavy brown boots, suddenly belched, temporarily interrupting his steady snoring to do so. A young woman wearing a dark blue overcoat and a small blue felt hat looked across at him, sniffed and tutted, and then looked away. She clasped her gloved hands neatly in her lap and stared out of the window. She was in her late 20s or early 30s, but her clothes made her look much older. A young woman in her early 20s loudly shushed the two boys who were travelling with her. I suppose they were her sons. They seemed to find great humour in the sounds emanating from the fat man's body, and had to struggle to contain their amusement. A man in a grey suit buried himself in his morning newspaper. An elderly woman wearing a black dress, black coat, black hat and black shoes glowered around at all of us, as though holding us all responsible for failing to protect her from these social insults, before folding her arms across her chest, as though defiantly barricading herself against our world. The train, slowing down, started to follow a long, gentle curve to the left. Looking out of the window, I saw a sign on the platform which told me that we had arrived at the end of the line. Barnstaple. This was it. Grown-up reality, responsibility, and heaven knows what else lay just a few miles away from here. My mouth felt dry, and I could feel a squadron of butterflies becoming airborne in my stomach. Politely, I waited until the other passengers had left the train, and then picked up my black leather doctor's bag and my cheap but capacious blue cardboard suitcase and shuffled along the corridor. I was clambering down onto the platform when I realised that something had happened a few yards in front of me, halfway between the train door and the exit from the platform. As I got closer to the crowd which had formed, I realised that the fat man in the tweed suit, gaiters and heavy brown boots was the centre of attraction. He was lying flat on his back on the platform, and even from a distance it was clear to a trained medical mind that all was not well. "Excuse me," I heard myself saying, as I gently squeezed my way through between a tall, thin man in a brown trilby and the elderly woman dressed all in black. I dropped my suitcase outside the circle, but kept a tight hold on my doctor's bag. It contained the instruments of my profession, and without it, I would have felt as vulnerable and as useless as a gunfighter entering the OK Corral without his pistols. "I'm a doctor," I explained diffidently, hoping that this confession would excuse my behaviour but not attract too much attention. I had spoken quietly, but the response was as immediate and as dramatic as if I'd shouted the words at the top of my voice. These magic words, "I'm a doctor," would, I was to discover in the fullness of time, part any crowd. The circle widened, and I was aware of every eye being trained on me. Every eye except two, that is. The exceptions belonged to the young woman in the blue woolen coat and the blue felt hat, who had sat across the aisle from me on the train. She was stooping beside the prostrate fat man in the tweed suit, having unbuttoned her coat to make kneeling easier. "Give me a hand," she said, without looking up, but moving round so that she was behind the man's head. She nodded towards his feet. I put down my black bag. "Is he all right?" I asked hesitantly. "Shouldn't we do a few tests before we move him? He might have damaged his spine." "He's drunk," said the woman in the blue coat firmly. As though anxious to confirm her diagnosis, the fat man suddenly sat up. He opened his eyes and looked around him, lifted one hand, as though he wanted to make a gesture of some kind, and then collapsed flat on his back again with a loud burp. I found myself engulfed in a suffocating cloud of stale beer. The woman in the blue coat sighed wearily, as though none of this was new to her. "Let's get him into a taxi." She lifted his head and shoulders, and I lifted his feet, and together we carried him out to the station forecourt. There were half a dozen taxis queuing there, but the woman in the blue coat ignored the first three and headed straight for the fourth in line, a rather battered vehicle of indeterminate make that was heavily pockmarked with rust patches. To my surprise, the drivers who had been overlooked made no protests. The driver of the rust-speckled car put down his newspaper, climbed out, and opened the back door so that we could push our passenger in.
"Drunk again?"
inquired the driver, helping us to manhandle the fat man into the taxi.
"It's the last Wednesday of the month," answered the woman in blue, as though this explained everything.
The taxi driver frowned.
"LVA meeting in Exeter?"
The taxi driver grunted and nodded. The fat man belched again. I bent down, picked up one of the fat man's shoes that had come off as we had pushed him into the car, and tried to fit it back onto his foot.
Mysteriously, the shoe seemed several sizes too small. I dropped the shoe onto the floor beside the unshod foot, backed out of the car and stood up. The woman in the blue coat and the taxi driver were both standing waiting. His shoe had come off, I explained apologetically. If you're coming with us, you'd better get your luggage, said the woman in the blue coat. I frowned. I didn't understand. You're Dr. Brownlow's new assistant, aren't you? I nodded. How did you know? There can't be all that many new doctors arriving in Barnstable Station today. She walked round to the other side of the taxi, opened the front door, and got in.
Do you need a hand with your luggage, doctor?
Asked the taxi driver. He handed me a grubby visiting card upon which was printed, Peter Marshall, taxi driver. Underneath was printed, Funerals and Weddings a Speciality. There was a Bilbury telephone number. When I'd had a chance to read the card, Mr. Marshall reached out and took it off me. No, thank you, I said. There's only one case and a bag. I suddenly remembered that I'd left them both standing in the middle of the platform. I turned away from the taxi and ran back into the station. Both the suitcase and the black bag were standing exactly where I'd dropped them. I picked them up and carried them over to the taxi. Mr. Marshall had opened the boot, which was full of old oil cans, dirty pieces of rope, old newspapers, and a large quantity of shrink-wrapped toilet rolls, stacked neatly in two large cardboard boxes. "Delivery for the duck," explained the taxi driver cryptically, pushing the toilet rolls to one side. He had, I noticed for the first time, a very thin moustache on his upper lip. He wore a flat cap that had a greasy mark on the peak where he touched it countless times with thumb and forefinger, and a badly creased suit that had rather a lot of stains on it. He took my suitcase and carefully laid it down in the centre of the boot. Too late, I noticed that much of the boot lining seemed to be soaked with oil. He then placed my black bag on top of the suitcase. I still felt more than a little uncertain about all this. You are going to Bilbury? The taxi driver nodded.
That's where we're going, doctor. Don't you worry about a thing.
He opened the near side rear door of the taxi for me to get in. But the fat man in the tweed suit had collapsed sideways and was now taking up the whole of the rear seat. After trying to push him upright and failing, Mr. Marshall scratched his head and walked to the front of the car.
Would you mind sharing the front seat with Mrs. Wilson? He asked.
He opened the front passenger door and, in lieu of a smile, showed me his gums. He didn't seem to have any teeth at all. Much later, I discovered that he had a set of false teeth, but that he only wore them on occasions which he deemed special. The woman in the blue coat looked first at him and then at me. I stared at him and then at her. Mrs. Wilson could politely be described as having a fulsome figure. I'm Kay Wilson, said the woman. She swung her legs sideways, showing an indelicate amount of stocking top and bare white thigh, and clambered out of the taxi again. I'll sit on your lap, she offered. I climbed into the taxi and took her place. As I have already mentioned, Mrs. Wilson was not a small woman, and her weight was not insubstantial. Fortunately, the springs in the taxi seat had long since lost all their resilience, and our combined weight meant that the seat sank close enough to the floor for Mrs. Wilson to get her head into the car. Once inside, she fidgeted about, as though trying to get comfortable. Even through her thick woolen coat, I could feel the bony structure of her firmly structured supporting undergarments. The air around me was thick with her perfume, to which I suspected I was probably allergic.
Mrs. Wilson is our district nurse, explained the taxi driver,
turning the ignition key in an attempt to start the taxi's ancient engine. I realised then that the clothes Mrs. Wilson was wearing were her official uniform. I extricated my right hand from between the handbrake and the side of the passenger seat upon which we were sitting and offered it to Mrs. Wilson, inspired by a sudden sense of professional courtesy. we were in the act of shaking hands when we were both projected forwards, as the engine caught and the car, which was in gear, suddenly jerked forwards. The district nurse was crushed against the car's worn vinyl dashboard, and I, the more fortunate of the two of us, was crushed against the infinitely more pliant district nurse.
"Maybe we should fasten the seatbelt," I suggested.
Mrs. Wilson, her hat now resting at an unlikely angle, moved her head so that she could look at me and raised an eyebrow doubtfully. Behind us, I heard the fat man in the tweed suit cursing noisily. Judging from the pressure on the back of my seat, he had rolled forwards onto the floor. I felt a sneeze developing, and, in an attempt to distract myself from such a potentially hazardous incident, I wriggled around so that I could reach the dangling seatbelt clip with my left hand. I then tried to pass the seatbelt clip from my left hand to my right, but this wasn't quite so easy. The main consequence of my struggle was that I pulled Mrs. Wilson even closer to me than before. Deep out of reach and trapped in my trouser pocket, I could feel my Swiss Army penknife pressing into my leg.
"Let me help you, Doctor,"
said Mrs. Wilson, taking the seatbelt clip from my left hand and putting it into my right for me. She turned towards me when she completed this simple manoeuvre, and I noticed that her face was looking distinctly flushed. She put her right arm around my shoulders and pulled herself even closer to me so that I could fasten the safety belt.
"Got it,"
I announced proudly. This was no mean feat, since the taxi was bouncing around like a fairground ride. Mrs. Wilson didn't seem too interested. Her eyes were closed and she was breathing heavily. My Swiss Army penknife was pressing even harder against my thigh, and I could feel my leg going numb.
"Are you all right?" I asked the nurse.
Mrs. Wilson smiled, nodded, and murmured something inaudible. In the back of the car, I could hear the fat man in the tweed suit talking to himself.
"What's an LVA?"
I asked the taxi driver. Mr. Marshall hunched over his steering wheel as he urged his ancient taxi onwards past a touring caravan being towed by an underpowered motor car, turned towards me looking puzzled.
"I heard Mrs. Wilson tell you that your other passenger had been to an LVA meeting in Exeter."
"Oh," said the driver. He swung the steering wheel hard to the left and swerved back in front of the car just in time to avoid crashing head-on into a tractor that was coming towards us.
"The LVA is the Licensed Victuallers Association," he explained. "Frank is the landlord of the Duck."
"The Duck?"
"The Duck and Puddle. The pub."
"Is that the Duck and Puddle in Bilbury?"
"That's the one," nodded Mr. Marshall. "You'll be staying there, I expect."
He jerked his head backwards.
"That's your new landlord."
The village of Bilbury lies about 10 miles to the east of Barnstable and about 3 miles south of the North Devon coast. Bilbury is one of the very few English villages that looks like a traditional village ought to look. The three most important buildings, the pub, the church and the village shop, all look out onto the village green. 1.5 acres of lush green grass that used to be kept closely cropped by the Bilbury goats, but which is now cut 6 times a year by one of the local farmers, working on contract for the county council. In addition to these three essential and conspicuous centres of public consumption and absolution, the village green is overlooked by a couple of dozen cottages, while around its edge stand 6 towering oaks, 2 equally impressive horse chestnut trees, and a single ash tree. A small stream meanders along one side of the green, at one end passing under the road in a hidden ditch, and at the other flowing across the road to make a ford that in summer often dries to a trickle, and sometimes dries completely, but in winter has been known to flood to a depth of over 18 inches. When Mr. Marshall's taxi drew up outside the Duck and Puddle public house, I was in no condition to take in any of this. Inhaling concentrated drafts of Mrs. Wilson's perfume for 30 minutes had left me rather light-headed, and my Swiss Army penknife had by now succeeded in deadening one of my femoral nerves more or less completely. The taxi driver disappeared in through the front door of the pub, leaving the district nurse and I to disentangle ourselves from the seatbelt as best we could. Neither of us had moved more than a couple of inches when Mr. Marshall reappeared with a small, slightly built, worried-looking woman in her early 40s, who was dressed in a pale pink jumper and a pair of very tight blue jeans. This, I was to discover, was Jilly Parsons, the landlady of the Duck and Puddle and the wife of the unconscious licensed victualler lying on the floor of the back of the taxi. Mrs. Parsons didn't seem surprised or alarmed to see her husband lying there. She reached in, took hold of a random handful of suit cloth, and yanked him out of the car in a single, impressively smooth movement. Seemingly inspired by this, Mrs. Wilson made a supreme effort and, by swinging open the car door and grasping hold of the top edge with one hand, succeeded in pulling her head and shoulders out of the car completely. Unfortunately, although her coat and dress made every effort to follow, her body and legs seemed unwilling to leave the taxi. I found myself flushing with embarrassment as I stared down at a mysterious and confusing vision of lingerie, buckles, silk stockings, and white flesh. By this time, half a dozen villagers had left the pub and, all clutching pint or half-pint glasses, were standing around watching. The tweed-suited landlord of the Duck and Puddle had made a sudden and surprising recovery and was now standing, looking doleful, as his wife, hands planted firmly on her hips, told him what she thought of him. Three small and scruffy boys who had been throwing sticks up into a horse chestnut tree in vain attempts to dislodge early conkers abandoned their exhausting endeavours and joined the enthusiastic audience. Eventually, the taxi driver came over and freed Mrs. Wilson from his motor car by the simple expedient of taking hold of her shoulders and pulling hard. She shot out of the car like a cork out of a champagne bottle, and the two of them landed on the dusty road in front of the pub. "You must be the doctor," said Mrs. Parsons, the landlady, turning away from her husband, ignoring the sprawling Mr. Marshall and Mrs. Wilson, and approaching as I clambered out of the car. "Yes," I confirmed, standing up and then falling down onto the road alongside the taxi driver and the district nurse, in one fluid and seemingly well-practiced movement. My Swiss Army penknife had succeeded in arresting the nerve supply to my right leg so successfully that it had been blissfully unaware of its duties when I had tried to stand on it. My arrival in Bilbury had not been quite as dignified as I might have hoped. My room at the Duck and Puddle overlooked the village green. Mrs. Parsons, who seemed disappointed to discover that her new guest was as prone to falling over as her husband and the rest of her customers, performed the usual rituals without enthusiasm. She opened the window and then shut it again. She opened the wardrobe, rattled the row of wire hangers which hung on a single wooden rail, and then shut it again. She pointed to the sink and told me what it was, showed me how the taps worked and pressed a hand on the bed to demonstrate its pliability. She then pointed out the bedside lamp, the tiny child's desk and chair that stood beside the window, opened and shut the drawers of the dressing table, and pulled the cord which dangled over the bed to turn on the main light. As she left the room, she used the light switch just by the door to turn the light off again. She paused just before she left. "Dr. Brownlow asked if you'd be kind enough to call on him as soon as you've settled in," she announced, rather formally. Having passed this message on, she looked around, as though taking a last-minute inventory, turned away, and closed the door behind her. I shook the worst of the dust off my jacket, brushed my trousers with my hand, and shared the contents of my blue suitcase between the wardrobe and the dressing table. Then I placed my brand new doctor's bag on the desk by the window and limped back down the stairs again. My leg still wasn't completely recovered. the pub had either been built in some long distant era, when customers were a good deal shorter than I am, or when watching customers crack their skulls against solid wooden beams was considered good sport. Whatever the explanation, I counted 6 possible danger points between my bedroom and the pub's front door. At 2 of these sites, the landlord had attempted to minimise the extent of possible damage by tacking an old piece of carpet across the beams. The gesture might have been more effective had the carpet not been threadbare. On my first descent, I succeeded in banging my head on every possible impediment. "Excuse me," I said to Mrs. Parsons, now standing behind the bar and pulling a pint of locally brewed beer for an eager customer. "Could you tell me how to find Dr. Brownlow's?" Mr. Parsons, the landlord, was standing at the far end of the bar, and although erect, he did not yet look entirely conscious. "Turn right out of the front door," Mrs. Parsons answered, without lifting her eyes from her work, "and then follow the road around the village green. Take the first lane on the right. It's signposted to Coombe Martin. You'll see the gates and the drive leading to Dr. Brownlow's house 100 yards on your right." Murmuring my thanks, I followed her directions faithfully, and less than 10 minutes later, found myself staring at the largest pair of iron gates I'd ever seen. The gates, which were painted black and which stood wide open, were suspended from hinges built into 2 huge stone pillars, upon each of which rested massive stone griffins. On either side of the pillars, a 9-foot-high stone wall separated the road from the grounds within. I studied the gates and the pillars, looking for a name, an inscription, or some sign that this was what I was looking for. But I could find nothing. I stood still for a moment and stared up the driveway. Flanked by 70-foot-tall poplars, the drive looked to be several miles long. I could see no sign of any house. I didn't know much about country doctors, but this all looked a little grand to me. Maybe, I thought, Dr. Brownlow lived in part of the house. Or maybe he had a cottage in the grounds. Whatever the explanation, I was pretty sure that I was at the right place, unless Mrs. Parsons had deliberately sent me off on a wild goose chase. I was comforted by the thought that she didn't look like a woman who enjoyed sending strangers chasing off after wild geese. After walking for what seemed like a modest eternity, I finally saw the house. It looked like something out of a horror film, the sort of place that Dracula or Dr. Frankenstein might have found homely. Built entirely of grey stone, softened slightly by several acres of dark green ivy, it wasn't so much a house as a castle. There was no moat, but there were towers, battlements, and mullion windows. Apart from the ivy, the only colour breaking up the grey of the stone was provided by a Union Jack flying from a pole, which was fixed at an acute angle to the front of the central tower. Directly underneath the flag, and flanked by 2 huge stone lions, was the front door. It was about 12 feet high and was decorated with scores of very solid-looking metal studs. Incongruously, a large ginger tomcat lay curled up beside one of the stone lions. I couldn't see anything that looked like a doorbell, so I knocked on the door with my knuckles. The door, which from the sound my knuckles made seemed about 3 feet thick, soaked up the sound I made with ease. Certain that my knocking had been a waste of time and effort, I raised my fist to give the door a more appropriate hammering. But before I could land my first blow, the door surprised me by opening. The man who opened the door wore a black frock coat, black trousers, a white shirt, and a black bow tie. He was tiny, wizened, and looked at least 80 years old. Pulling the door open seemed to take up an awful lot of his remaining energy. "I'm looking for Dr. Brownlow," I said hesitantly. "Can you tell me where to find him, please?"
"This is Dr. Brownlow's residence,"
wheezed the old man, producing a silver card tray from behind his back. He held the tray out to me.
"Do you have a card, sir?"
I stared at the tray and then at him. I didn't have any visiting cards. I'd never been to a house where people asked you for visiting cards. I didn't think there were still any such homes in existence. The only people I knew who had visiting cards were salesmen for pharmaceutical products and life insurance policies. "I'm afraid not," I mumbled. I tried to look past the old man, but it was impossible to see anything behind him except darkness. I told him my name and explained that Dr. Brownlow was expecting me. The old man looked me up and down very carefully.
"I'll speak to Dr. Brownlow," he said.
Then he shut the door. Shortly after I'd decided that he wasn't coming back, but just before I left, the door opened again.
"Dr. Brownlow will see you now, sir,"
said the old man. He pulled the door wide open so that I could enter, and then, the moment I was safely inside, closed it shut behind me. With the door shut, it was so dark that I could hardly see anything, and so cold that I shivered involuntarily. The skinny old man turned left and shuffled along a corridor that looked long enough to park a train in. Since he walked slowly, I had plenty of time to look around me. The corridor was about 10 feet wide, with a thin strip of threadbare red carpet running along its centre. On each side of the strip of carpet, I could see the bare stone flags that made up the floor of the corridor. The walls of the corridor were decorated with huge old oil paintings, hung in battered but massive gilt frames. We walked until I felt sure that we must be close to the county's border, and then the skinny old man stopped, knocked on a huge oak door, and put his ear to the panelling before opening the door and ushering me into an extraordinarily small room. The most remarkable thing about this room was that it was higher than it was wide or long. It was, I suppose, no more than 12 or 15 feet square, but the gap between the floor and the ceiling seemed to be at least 20 feet. Sitting at a huge, scrubbed pine kitchen table in the centre of the room was a bald, plump man in his late 60s or early 70s, who looked over his half-moon spectacles as I entered and beamed broadly. Apart from a window set high in one wall, the room was lined with shelves, upon which stood rows of books and dusty bound copies of old medical and scientific journals. Behind the seated occupant of the room stood an examination couch, which was piled high with yet more books. Tufts of horsehair showed that the contents of the couch were making a determined effort to escape. The room's occupant waved a hand in greeting.
"I'm Dr. Brownlow. Thank you for coming."
He looked over my shoulder at the elderly manservant who was still hovering behind me.
"Thank you, Bradshaw," he said. Then he looked at me. "Would you like a cup of tea?"
"No, thank you," I said. "I'm fine."
"Wise fellow," whispered Dr. Brownlow confidentially. "Bradshaw has never got the knack of making tea, and Ethel's out somewhere today."
He peered around me and raised his voice again.
"That's all, thank you, Bradshaw."
I heard the door behind me click shut as Bradshaw left and realised that 30 square feet of solid oak makes a very different noise to the average modern door. I looked around. "Is this your study?"
"It's my consulting room," answered Dr. Brownlow. "It used to be the gun room, but it's one of the few rooms in the house that is small enough to keep reasonably warm in the winter."
He pointed the pen he was holding back over his shoulder towards two large electric fires, which stood side by side behind him. Even though it was still only early autumn, both fires were switched on.
"Sit yourself down," he said,
nodding to the empty chair in front of his table. I sat down and suddenly had a bizarre vision of a long line of infirm patients struggling along the corridor down which I just walked.
"Patients come to the back door,"
explained Dr. Brownlow, as though reading my thoughts.
It's a bit quicker. He sighed. Hardly anyone comes to the front door any more. When they do, Bradshaw always likes to give them the silver tray treatment.
I nodded. I'm afraid I don't have any visiting cards.
No one ever has, said Dr. Brownlow. At least no one I ever want to see. The last man who put a visiting card on that tray was a double-glazing salesman from Bristol. He was so excited by the prospect of double-glazing this place that it took me half a day to get rid of him.
It's a spectacular house, I said.
I like it, said Dr. Brownlow simply.
I could feel a little cramp developing in my left leg again, so I stretched my leg out in front of me underneath the table. As I did so, I felt my toes hit something soft. I heard a growl and pulled my leg back quickly and instinctively. I looked down but could see nothing.
Don't worry, said Dr. Brownlow comfortingly. It's only Max.
Max?
One of my dogs, explained Dr. Brownlow. He gets nervous eczema if he's away from me for too long.
What sort is he? I asked brightly. I get anxious in the company of dogs, but I didn't think I should be worried about a dog which suffered from nervous eczema.
A Doberman, answered Dr. Brownlow. I've got two. They're lovely dogs.
I felt myself going pale, and my terror must have shown.
They wouldn't harm a fly, Dr. Brownlow assured me. Are you settled in at the Duck and Puddle?
Yes, it seems very nice, thank you.
Good. Ready to start work tomorrow?
I swallowed hard. Yes, I lied. I was beginning to have severe doubts about the whole thing. I tried to think of an excuse for running away, but couldn't.
I'd like to have been here with you on your first morning, said Dr. Brownlow, but I've got to go to Exeter tomorrow.
What time does morning surgery start? I asked with a voice I only half recognised.
9. Then there will be just a few home visits afterwards, and the evening surgery is at 5:30. Simple. Miss Johnson will show you the ropes.
That's your secretary?
Secretary, receptionist, nurse. She does it all. Been with me for years. Knows everyone. Just ask her if you get any problems. She will sort you out.
Dr. Brownlow suddenly stood up. He was shorter than I'd expected he'd be.
I thought perhaps you wouldn't mind doing most of the night duties, he said. I'm getting a bit past it now, to be honest.
He started to move around the desk.
Bit of a dicky ticker, you know.
I started to say something sympathetic, but Dr. Brownlow waved the comment away with a shake of his hand. He moved towards the door.
Where did you park?
Park?
Your car.
I haven't got one, I admitted. Dr. Brownlow seemed startled.
Haven't got a car? You'll need one for tomorrow. Can't be a GP without a car.
He looked at his watch.
I've got to go to Ilfracombe. I'll drop you off at the Duck.
He smiled at me.
I'll do the night duty tonight, and then you can take over from tomorrow.
I nodded weakly. He opened the consulting room door and turned right, going in the opposite direction to the way Bradshaw had brought me.
That's Miss Johnson's office, he said, pointing to a door split horizontally in two. It used to be the boot room.
He nodded towards another room, painted white and decorated with colourful health education posters.
The patients sit in there.
A mixture of wooden chairs were arranged in a circle around the walls.
Used to be the flower room.
Flower room?
Oh, big houses have them. Somewhere for the gardener to lay out flowers for the house.
Yes, of course.
It works quite well, said Dr. Brownlow. We've managed to make a self-contained surgery suite down here.
He looked around, obviously proud of it all. A moment or two later, we were outside the back of the house. Dr. Brownlow strode across towards a large coach house that had its own clock tower. He pulled open two huge wooden doors to reveal an elderly black Rolls Royce.
I bought it 30 years ago, he said. It's a 2025. The most reliable car ever built.
I climbed in beside him, and he drove me back to the Duck and Puddle. It was the first time I'd ever ridden in a Rolls Royce, and despite the car's age, I was astonished at its luxury and quiet, smooth power. It seemed to me that general practice was going to be full of surprises. I had 100 things on my mind, but my first task was to get hold of a motor car. I'd passed my driving test when I was 17, but had never owned a car of my own. I'd never had enough money, and there had never been much need. When you're living, studying, and working in a teaching hospital, a car isn't exactly essential. I had £45 saved up in my bank account, but Dr. Brownlow's advertisement had promised to pay me £60 a week on top of my board and lodging at the Duck and Puddle. So, for the first time in my life, I felt as rich as a king. The problem was not so much finding the money to pay for a car, but finding a car to buy. Innocently, I thought that since £45 was a lot of money to me, it would be a lot of money to a car dealer. Everything was made infinitely more difficult by the fact that I hadn't seen a garage since I'd arrived in North Devon. Mrs. Parsons had my evening meal ready when Dr. Brownlow dropped me off, and she seemed to have forgiven my rather bizarre arrival. Her husband, Frank, seemed to have made a miraculous recovery and was standing laughing and joking in the public bar. "We usually serve our residents' meals in here," said Mrs. Parsons, showing me into the pub's small and totally deserted lounge bar. The main difference I could spot between the two bars was that in the lounge bar, the red leather chairs and benches were a little less battered and scuffed, and the ashtrays smaller, though there was no dartboard, no bar billiards table, and no fire in the hearth. Later I discovered that the beer was a penny a pint more expensive in the lounge bar. I can still remember my first meal at the Duck and Puddle. Someone, probably Mrs. Parsons herself, had written out the menu in neat handwriting on a piece of white cardboard and had leant it up against the cruet. There was no choice. I had minestrone soup, followed by homemade steak and kidney pie and chips and peas, and I finished with a large bowlful of strawberry ice cream with a blob of Devon clotted cream balanced on top of it. Every mouthful was excellent. Simple but nourishing pub fare. After the food I'd been used to eating in hospital, I thought I'd died and gone to heaven. When I'd finished, I took the remains of my pint of beer. "You get one pint of beer with every meal except breakfast," Mrs. Parsons had told me. "Anything more, you'll have to pay for yourself." Into the public bar.
"Just passing through the village?"
asked Frank Parsons, the landlord, when I asked him to refill my glass. "I'm staying here," I reminded him. He looked at me, a frown on his face. "I arrived this afternoon," I explained. "We came together from the station."
"Oh, you're the doctor,"
said the landlord, a broad grin developing on his face.
"I'm sorry about that,"
he apologised, putting my refill glass back down in front of me. He leant forward a few inches.
"I never remember anything much that happens when I go down to an LVA meeting," he confided. "All a bit of a blur, you know."
I wasn't surprised, but didn't say so.
"Though, from what I heard, you must have had a few jars before you got here, eh?"
It was my turn to frown and look puzzled.
"The wife told me," he said. "Arse over cap before you got in through the door."
"Oh, that. I had cramp in my leg. It was my Swiss Army penknife." The landlord exploded in laughter.
"That's a good one," he exclaimed cheerily. "Must remember that one. Cramp in the leg, eh? Swiss Army penknife."
He leant forwards again and touched the side of his nose with his forefinger.
"Don't you worry, doctor," he assured me. "The wife's the very soul of discretion, and you can trust me."
I handed him a pound note to pay for the drink. I had no small change in my pockets. The landlord pushed the note back across the counter towards me.
"I'll put it on the slate for you," he said. "You don't want to be worrying with money every time you want a drink."
He leant forward across the bar counter again.
and you don't need to worry even if word does get out that you like a drop," he said. "There's no one round here who's likely to take offence, saving perhaps the vicar."
"Do you know where I could find Mr. Marshall?" I asked him, taking a sip from my glass. It was good beer.
"Mr. Marshall,"
repeated Mr. Parsons thoughtfully. He pursed his lips, screwed up his eyes, and then shook his head.
"I don't think I know anyone called Mr. Marshall," he said sadly.
"The taxi driver," I explained. "Mr. Marshall, the taxi driver. I think he lives in the village." I paused. "He brought us all over from Barnstable."
"Oh, Pete," said the landlord, grinning. "I didn't know you meant Pete."
"Does he come into the bar?" I asked.
"He does, and he doesn't," said the landlord enigmatically. "But usually he does."
"Do you know if he's likely to be in tonight?"
"I couldn't say precisely," said Mr. Parsons. "Do you want a taxi then?"
"No," I shook my head. "But there are a couple of things I need to see him about. First, I never paid him for this afternoon's journey. And second, I wanted to ask him if he knows anywhere around here where I could buy a car."
"Oh, don't you worry about Pete's bill," Mr. Parsons reassured me. "He'll run a tab for you, no problem. You don't want to be finding cash every time you want to go somewhere, do you?"
I suppose I ought to have been worried by all these tabs I was running up, but to be honest, I found it all rather pleasant. It made me feel part of the village.
"Excuse me,"
said a voice I hadn't heard before. I turned towards it and saw a tall, well-built man in his 20s.
"I couldn't help overhearing you say that you want to buy a car."
The speaker was wearing a scruffy brown leather jacket, a pair of well-worn oil-stained jeans, and a faded T-shirt that managed to look grubby, even though it was black. He had an unruly mop of curly, jet-black, collar-length hair that he was beginning to lose. "That's right," I nodded.
"What sort of car are you looking for?"
"I don't know," I confessed. "Something second-hand? Fairly cheap, I'm afraid. But I need it urgently. Are you a dealer?"
"Me, a dealer?" he laughed. "I wouldn't trust a car dealer as far as I could kick one."
"No," I said. "I suppose not."
"How much can you afford to spend?"
"No more than £45, I told him. "That's all the money I've got." The man in the leather jacket sucked in air between his teeth. The sum didn't seem to impress him. He picked up his glass, which was empty, and stared into it as though reproaching it for being empty. "Can I buy you a drink?" I asked, responding readily to the cue.
"Oh, that's very kind of you," said the man in the leather jacket,
seemingly surprised by my generosity.
"Very kind of you indeed. Be rude to refuse. I'll have a pint of special if that's all right with you."
I turned towards the landlord, who had been chatting to an elderly man who wore a grey Macintosh and a brown Homburg, and who was drinking half a pint of stout. But he'd started to pull the pint of special before I had the chance to pass on the order.
"My name's Robinson," said the man in the leather jacket, holding out a hand. "But people call me Thumper."
I shook his hand and introduced myself.
"You're the new doctor," I nodded. "Pleased to meet you," said Thumper,
taking my hand again and pumping it up and down. I rescued my hand and massaged it gently in an attempt to get some blood flowing through the tissues again.
"You need something with a bit of class," said Thumper. "It wouldn't do for the new doctor to be driving around in any old wreck."
"I don't think it matters too much what it looks like," I said. "The important thing is that it's reliable."
"Reliable isn't enough," said Thumper. "Drink up. I know just the thing for you."
He picked up his glass, lifted it to his lips, and slowly but steadily drank it dry. When it was empty, he put it down on the bar, wiped the froth off his lips, and walked towards the front door. In an ancient Ford pickup truck that had what looked like metal farm gates welded to the back and front, Thumper drove me to a farm in the nearby village of Paracombe. The truck shook like a fairground ride and sounded as though it had several terminal problems.
"Wait here a moment," he told me,
skidding to a halt in a muddy forecourt, and sending chickens, cats and dogs flying and scurrying in all directions. He leapt out of the cab and disappeared into the farmhouse. When he emerged a few minutes later, he had a huge and rather bad-tempered-looking man with him. Thumper smiled and waved for me to join them. I opened the cab door and jumped down into a deep mixture of mud and manure.
"Come and look at this," said Thumper, letting the farmer go ahead and whispering to me conspiratorially.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.